We are ready for change, Father. We need change in our lives, in our church,
yes,
in this world, in this town, in our community. We need change. We need an expression of righteousness that shall shake the hearts of men and women, Father. And I pray, Father, that as we enter into this time of leadership training, that you will break us to the point where we can express Jesus Christ to a broken world. In Jesus' name. Hallelujah. Amen. All right. Welcome to We Would See Jesus Leadership Class. The world needs to see Jesus. This church needs to see Jesus. It's not enough just to talk about it. It's not enough just to think about it. We can pray about it, but then we have to express it. And so the world needs to see this Christ that we're talking about. Needs to see what happened at the cross and the cross coming forward to the time that we're in. Amen? Okay, so we're going to just kind of lay some groundwork this morning, or this evening, this morning. Whew, my knees are screwed up. But anyway, we're going to read this. Spiritual leadership. The activity of leading a group of believers or a church can, or the ability to do this. Leadership involves establishing a clear vision. And with, we need the vision, both personally, what God has said to us individually, and we need a vision as a church. We need a clear vision. But the scripture says, write the vision, make it plain. Write it down. So that it's available for everybody to look at. So one of the things that we're going to do while we're in this class is that we're going to find out what our individual visions are, how those visions, come on in, George, how those visions mesh with the vision for the church, and our individual part in seeing those visions come to pass. Amen?
Amen?
Because your vision and my vision, all of us together should add up to what the vision for the house is. And our individual play in each one of those areas. Okay, establish a clear vision. Sharing that vision with others so that they will contribute and follow willingly. Number three, provide the information and knowledge and methods to realize that vision and coordinate and balance the conflicting interests of all members because there will be conflict. Do we have any more? Yeah, okay, cool. It's a big thing that the church has been without for the most part. And I'm talking about the church, not in the local sense, but in the church in the universal sense, has been without proper leadership for a long time. The call for holiness is a forgotten call. The call for righteousness is something that you don't hear burning from the hearts of preachers too much anymore. The call for understanding and knowing what the leadership of the Holy Ghost is something that has been thrown under the tracks, and we don't do that anymore. So what I'm hoping, it is my prayer, that out of this will come leaders that will set examples for a world that doesn't know Christ. A leader steps up in the time of crisis and is able to think and act creatively to mediate situations. because they will arise. Sometimes the enemy will lie to somebody and they'll bring it forward, sometimes conflict, if not understood, can create real big problems. But if we're going to be leaders in the sense that we're church leaders, then we have got to be able to bring our emotions down under the leadership of our spirit and let the Holy Ghost reign in our emotions so that we can deal effectively with any kind of conflict to the resolution that will bring glory to the body of Christ and the Lord Jesus. Amen?
Amen?
Amen. Amen. It's got to happen. Brother Roy and I have personally had seen some of this happen in our lives. He's been to my house more than once. we've seen some resolution that has brought tremendous blessing to me. So it's a good thing sometimes when conflict arises, because then it shows that there is a problem and that we can bring resolution to a problem. Leadership is different than management. Management is a skill you can learn. Leadership is a call that you have to have. You can't learn leadership. You can be mentored into leadership, but you can't manufacture leadership qualities. You just can't do it. It's something that God calls you to. And I hope that in this process of being here, that we can refine the call of leadership. That in the years that all of us have been involved in various stages of leadership, different kinds of leadership, I'm hoping that we can bring that to bear on this church and see this church revolutionized by the Spirit of God. Amen.
Amen.
Okay. Leadership is a divine calling in the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. Vision. Proverbs 29:18. Would somebody like to read that? Everybody have Bibles? Okay. Would somebody like to read that? It's important to where we're going. God. Paul said that he was addicted to the ministry of the saints. Jesus said that the house of God ate him. I mean, there's a zeal that has to be there, a passion for the house of God. And Nehemiah had such a passion for the walls that were broken down, the walls that were torn up by a nation that forgot its God, who forgot that this God that they served was an all-consuming fire. And they let go of some of the very things that God had brought them to. They forgot where they came from and what God had done for them. And Nehemiah had this passion to rebuild the walls of Jerusalem. And out of that passion, in spite of all resistance, in spite of every opposition that was against him, in spite of everything, they rebuilt the walls. Anybody remember, without looking at your paper?
Yes.
How many days? 52 days they built. It built the entire walls around Jerusalem. They rebuilt them in 52 days. Nehemiah said, in the book of Nehemiah, it says that the people had a mind to work. Nehemiah brought a vision to those people. And out of that vision came the completion of the rebuilding of the walls in record. There is no natural way that those walls should have been built in 52. If you know how big the walls of Jerusalem were, there's no natural way that those walls should have been built in 52 days. No natural way. But the people, they had, in one hand they built, and in another, their other hand, they had a sword or a weapon for defense. But in 52 days, that wall was complete. I read Nehemiah, I'm going, how in the world? Because of a supernatural God.
Hallelujah.
They were able to do exceedingly, abundantly, above all that they could think or ask. They built a wall around Jerusalem in 52 days. My God in heaven.
Mike, could I add a little something?
Sure, brother. Yeah,
that's
yeah.
New to me in my study of Nehemiah just recently is his great success was that you'll notice he put heads of homes in charge
in
of
section.
Certain sections all
right
around the wall. So it was like families fortifying the part of the wall that was going to protect them.
Exactly.
And they met a personal need in these people's lives, and they realized, this is not just about Jerusalem, this is about my kids, my grandkids.
Yes.
This, and so he had the wisdom to get the families on board.
Yes, sir.
And, it wasn't just Nehemiah, he had the wisdom to get the leadership.
Yeah, they bought
and
in.
Families, they bought into it.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep. I can tell you that as well.
Sure.
I was told the other day by a pastor friend of mine that before Nehemiah, which I've not studied this out myself, this is what I felt, before Nehemiah ever approached the king, that he fasted and prayed for approximately 6 months. It wasn't just a short period of time, 2 days. Right? This is something he had prayed over. He had put the time into before he ever approached the king. That way, when all this happened, he was prayed up and ready to go.
So, exactly.
So, it's a little side note there. So.
It's a good side note. It's a good side note. And in the building of the walls, the king and all those people got mad and upset because the walls were being built. They got permission to do it, but when they were doing it, they didn't, because the king didn't think that they would actually pull it off. But they actually pulled it off in 52 days. It's just amazing. So here we are. This church is in the middle of an area that is effectively godless. What would happen if we had such a vision for the lost and a vision for the kingdom of God? that it changed us to the point where we could see a doubling of our church. What would we say if we could say that in 52 days?
Miracle.
Was it not a miracle that the wall was built in 52
Amen.
Days?
That's right.
Can it not be a miracle when this church increases in 52 days? If we could take, I was listening to a minister the other day and he said this, that he had a vision for something. And for 6 months, he didn't watch television. He didn't listen to the news. He didn't speak an unkind word. He didn't let any negativity proceed out of his mouth, nor his family's mouth, for 6 months. If we did that for 6 months, to add to your challenge today, David, if we did that for 6 months and we concentrated on the vision of what God wants for Bethel, and we spoke to the vision and we call it as though it be not, as though it is done, even though it is not done. God spoke, and he spoke as if those things were already done, and they were done. Nehemiah put this, even though he laid the groundwork, he still put this vision out before all the leaders of families. They weren't a part of the preparation prayer. They were a part of the doing of the vision that God brought forth. But if the leadership of this church, if we're going to be leaders, if we're going to be spiritual leaders, then there's things that we've got to grab hold of and say, okay, I'm going to do what is necessary on my part to see this vision come to pass. This church needs growth.
Amen.
Right. It needs people. It needs men who are sold out to God.
Yes.
That can be an example to families. Just like he chose what? The heads of families. And it was for their protection that they were building their part of the wall. And if we can get men involved and say, this is for the protection of your families. And if we can see that happen, what would happen to Bethel? It would grow. It would grow astronomically. It would grow miraculously. And it would grow to the point where it would be a testimony, as the walls of Jerusalem were a testimony to all the kings and everybody that thought that they couldn't do it and were against the Jews doing what they were doing. It was a testimony that God could do something that was supernatural. And this area needs a witness of the supernatural. They need to see that this Jesus that we preach is more than just words. It is action. They need to see that this Jesus that we preach is not just talking about somebody being healed, but us going to the point where we are willing to do what is necessary to see healing of the body and the minds and the souls and the spirits of men and women, boys and girls. There's a lot of things that's going on around here. There's everything from sex trafficking to selling women to selling young kids in all kinds of stuff. Drugs, alcohol, anything that you can imagine is around this church. God wants to see it stop. He wants to see this area revived and set ablaze by the people of God. Amen? It can only happen if we take on the role of leaders. And leadership is not something that is taken lightly. It's something that is quite different than that. It's not a glorious place. It's not a place where you're going to receive the praise and the accolades of men. It is a place where you're going to be faced with the negativity of even people in the church concerning what God wants you to do. Amen? Because when change happens, people do not acclimate themselves to change very easily. But God wants to change this church for the good, for the better, actually for the best. Amen?
Amen.
Where there is no vision, no redemptive, progressive revelation of God, the people perish. But he who keeps the law of God, which includes that of man, blessed, happy, fortunate, and enviable is he. We don't actually keep the law of Moses anymore. But we keep the law of the Spirit that he is written in our hearts, that we are no longer in bondage to this world. We are free. We are the free. We are not of the bondwoman. We are from the free woman. Amen? Amen. Passion for the house of God. They built the wall in 52 days. Malachi. Chapter 3. Verse 1, it says this, "Behold, I will send my messenger, and he shall prepare the way before me. And the Lord whom ye seek shall suddenly come to his temple, even the messenger of the covenant, whom ye delight in. Behold, he shall come, saith the Lord of hosts. But who may abide the day of his coming, and who shall stand when he appeareth? For he is like a refiner's fire, and like a fuller's soap. And he shall sit as a refiner and a purifier of silver, and he shall purify the sons of Levi, and purge them as gold and silver, that they may offer unto the Lord an offering in righteousness." And when there's purification in the house of God, the offering that we bring before God, in the New Testament, it says our offering is what? The fruit of our lips, bringing praise to God. That's the offering that we bring. We bring the offering of our obedience before God. We no longer bring calves and bulls and bullocks and sheep and lambs and goats. We don't, and turtle doves. We don't bring those anymore. But we bring the offering of the fruit of our lips. We declare that God is God and there is none else. We declare that Jesus is the Son of the living God and there is no other one that can bring salvation to men's soul. We declare it with our mouth. When we as leaders come into the house of God, we need to come prepared. God made a statement. He said, "I'm going to prepare for you a table in the midst of your enemies." So there was a preparation that was made in front of all the enemies of God, and God prepared a table. We have to prepare ourselves to come and offer an offering of praise in the midst of an untoward generation, so that God can come and change the lives of men, because God inhabits the praises of his people. So we have to prepare a place for him to come and fellowship with us, and we do it with our praise. Because when he comes to town to visit a church who is preparing a place for him of praise, then when he passes by people's homes in the Spirit, there is a conviction that comes. If any of you remember the Azusa move that happened in California, letters that went through the postal services, when they would go into a post office in a city, that God would move in revival in that town just because of the anointing that was on that letter as it passed by. How much more we as living epistles should we cause a consternation to the forces of darkness and a release of God's anointing in this region, because we are living letters that are influenced and influenced by the Holy Ghost and should be flowing in the Spirit. This river of life, we need to be flowing in it.
Yes.
So that the river of life can affect this town. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. It requires us as leaders to do that. If there is no investment, there is no return. There's got to be an investment. That investment is that when Tisha stands up there or sits up there, or whoever is there and says, let us give praise to God. Now understand what I'm getting ready to say. It is not a rebuke, it is instruction. But praise is not silent.
Absolutely.
Praise is loud.
Yes.
If you could only hear heaven right now. If you could only hear the voices of many waters that are giving praise to the King. If you could only hear the angels in their adoration of God Almighty. If you could only hear the seven beasts as they are going around the God that we serve and they're crying, holy, 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 day and night, 24 hours a day. There's no time there, but they do it all the time. If you could hear how loud that is, it's deafening in its loudness. So when we offer up praise, it should be without reservation. Because if we are reserved in our praise, you're holding back a part of you from God. You're reserving something that is not yours to reserve because you have been bought with a price. You are not your own. You are God's. You have been purchased with the precious blood of Jesus. And that blood and the act of redemption is worth everything that we can give in response to it. Praise. When people walk in here and we're in a time of praise, people ought to know that we are. They ought to be able to hear in the parking lot the voices of the redeemed that are loud enough to be heard outside the walls of this building and create such a stir in their spirit that they say, there's something going on in there. I've got to go find out what that is. I've got to see what these people are rejoicing about. Why are they lifting their voices like that over a God they can't see? But what they don't know is that explanation for what we are and what we do will come from thunderous preaching over the pulpits of this church. And they will understand that there's a reason for which we do what we do.
Yes, yes. Amen.
Excuse me. I get real shook up with this stuff. For 46 years, I've been waiting for this to happen in this area. 46 years. We have held on to the promise of God that there was going to be a revival in this area that would literally shake the nations. It's been prophesied over this area. Not by men insignificant, but I'm talking about some significant prophets have said it. Not just one. Not just two, but three and four people have said that very thing. Verse 4, it says this, then shall the offering of Judah and Jerusalem be pleasant unto the Lord, as in the days of old, as in former years. And the Pentecostals, I mean, I don't know if you've ever been to a Rush Harbor meeting when there was sawdust on the floor. But I have. I've seen people dance and shout so much and the dust from the sawdust would fill the tent and you could hardly see what you were doing because there was such a commotion of praise. And God would visit. And the sick were healed. The blind were healed. The deaf had their ears unstopped. I didn't see this, but people actually had fingers grow back that were actually removed and had been cut off because of eye sockets that didn't have eyes. That people could hear that couldn't hear. And I want to tell you something. Something happens when the miraculous begins to happen in a house of God. You don't have to advertise. You don't have to say there's miracles happening. Because the reputation of those miracles spreads like wildfire.
Amen. Yes.
And people will come out of the woodwork because they have been in disappointment. They have been in fear. They have been in bondage. And when they hear that there's something going on that may bring them out of that position, they flock to it. Just like the woman with the issue of blood. She came crushing through the press and she said, if I can just touch the hem of his garment, I shall be made whole. People will come when Jesus is there because they know that there's healing for their lives. Don't even have to advertise. You don't even have to go out after them. They will come.
Yes.
They will come. Be pleasant unto the Lord as in the days of old. And some of us here remember the old Pentecost. Tent revivals.
Oh, yeah.
when you talked about revival, you knew what they were talking about.
Yes.
We're in a generation now that doesn't have a clue what revival is. They don't know what it means to be challenged to your core. They don't know what it is to see the miraculous. They don't know what it is to be changed from the inside out. They don't know what the effectual working of salvation is in the inward parts of a man or woman. They don't know that. They don't know what it is to see kids who are rambunctious and everything else sit on the seats of logs sawn in half and have them quiet before the presence of God because there is such a presence of God, they cannot be rebellious. But it's happened. It's happened in former years. So what do we need? We need the refiner to sit as a refiner and purify the gold and the silver. And that happens when we come together to worship a king who is worthy of our praise. Praise to you is a refining fire. Praise to me is a refining fire. Why is that? Because sometimes it is not comfortable to do. But God didn't call us to be in a place of ease. He called us to be in a place of constant change. He called the church to be a place of meeting with Almighty God. As in the former days. The modern church has forgot what those days were like. I have not. There are hearers who have not forgotten. We can't go back to those days. Those days are gone. But what we can do is bring ourselves to the place and allow God by the Spirit to bring us to the place where those fires are roaring once again.
Right.
Yeah. We can't go back. We can just look back and say, what a day that must have been.
Right.
Well, why can't we bring those fires forward? And why can't we say, what a day this is that we're living in? When the fires of the Holy Ghost are burning brightly and we are seeing a move of God that shakes this area for the glory of God. And Malachi Then shall the offering of Judah, what is Judah?
Praise.
The house of what? The house of praise. Yes, sir. You're okay, brother. You're all right. But Judah is the house of praise. And so if we want this restoration, the offering of Judah and Jerusalem, to be pleasant, then let's make it pleasant.
Yes.
That's part of being a leader, is doing things that isn't pleasant to your flesh and my flesh. Because the flesh wants to sit back and just barely participate. But how would it be if the leaders of this church would get up in the midst of praise and start walking or even running? I don't know about you, but I remember when we used to have Jericho marches. I haven't seen a Jericho march in a long time. Why? Where are they? Are there walls that need to be broken down? Yes. Are there fears that need to be destroyed? Yes. Are there healings that need to be made manifest? Yes. Are there giants that need to be killed? Yes. Are there lands that need to be conquered? How about Rosewood Heights?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yes. Jericho was a defensed city. And there are defenses in this town that have been raised up by the devil to keep the people that are in here from seeing the glory of God. And it sometimes takes a Jericho march.
Yes.
To be able to knock the walls down so that they can fear this God who wants to set them free. They're hiding behind those walls. The only way those walls are coming down is if we, the leaders, knock them down. By our praise. They walked around those walls 7 days or 6 days. On the seventh day, they walked around those walls 7 times. And at the end of the 7th time around, they shouted with such a great shout that the walls not only fell down, but they fell down flat. And if we want the resistance to be destroyed in this area, for the gospel to be effective and those walls of resistance to fall flat, then we've got to be willing to do what is uncomfortable to see that happen. All right. Are we all on the same page? Does it make sense? Is it word-based?
Yes.
If it's word-based, and we say, this is the word of God. And we say, yeah, we believe it from cover to cover. And when he says, worship me with all your strength, with all your heart, with all your mind, then what does he mean? When we hear the word praise, praise him with everything that lies within you. Praise him with a loud sounding trumpet. With the shout, with praise him with the clap, praise him with the dance. What does that mean? It's uncomfortable to do that at first. It's uncomfortable for people that are not used to doing that to do that. But it is that pressing through the resistance of the enemy's lies that is going to realize what God is trying to give this church to. An expression of his might and power. Amen? All right. on the second page of this. So we're going to start with the very basics so that we can all be on the same page. We're going to start with this. What is salvation? What does that mean? What do you think it means? What does it mean to you?
Freedom.
Yep. So, before we come back next week, think about that. What is salvation? What happens at salvation? What is the evidence of one that has received salvation? Those are three pretty important questions that we need to answer for ourselves. Out of the Word of God, what do these things mean? Not just what we've heard, not just what we've heard preached, not just what our denomination says, not just what we think it means, but what does the Word of God declare these things to be? Because there's a lot of misinformation out there that holds people still in bondage because they really don't understand what salvation is. They think it's something that you earn. There's no earning in this. There was a cross that a man hung upon. That was the full payment for salvation. He cried, "It is finished." And we're going to go on to, what is the baptism in the Holy Ghost? What happens when we are baptized in the Holy Ghost? What is the evidence of the baptism of the Holy Ghost? We all need to be able to answer these things. The Scripture teaches us we need to be able to give an answer for the hope that lies within us. This is going to be a challenge. It's going to be, I hope, a change for some of us. And then once we answer these questions, and once we thoroughly discuss them, and once we're settled, hello? It's my daddy talking.
Someone's not listening, getting their attention.
Remember what happened when Saul was going where he was going? And the folks that were with him heard thunderings, but Paul heard something quite different. Saul, Saul. Why do you kick against the pricks?
He was the one who only saw for a few minutes, and then he was blind until someone came and healed.
Yep. So once we're settled scripturally in these above areas, we're going to move on to leadership. But it's necessary for us to go to leadership all on the same page, all with a good understanding of what these six areas include. So that when we go on into leadership, we'll have a good basis for what leadership is. Not our way of thinking, or what has been done by our denomination, or been done historically, but the way the Scriptures define and lead us. We'll all be challenged and changed by the Word of God as we yield ourselves to the purpose and the plans of God for this church. So let us prepare our hearts with prayer to receive and thus lead under the guidance of the leadership of the Word of God and the Holy Ghost. Just like God prepares a table for us in the midst of our enemies, let's prepare our hearts to provide a place of habitation, not just visitation, but a place of habitation for the presence of God. Amen?
Amen.
Father, it is my desire to see this church grow and be everything that you've called it to be. The enemy has fought, has lied, and restrained long enough. Let us purpose in our hearts to see all the restraints that the enemy has thrown up before this church be broken down and fall flat. Let us rise to the challenge of seeing the anointing flow in this place so strongly that people sense that God is doing something at Bethel that is unusual and is scriptural and is powerful, and the witness of Christ is in this place with such an anointing that it changes people even as they walk in the door. Let there be such an anointing in this place that challenges us and the folks that come here. People are looking for answers, Father. They're running to and fro. They're halting between decisions and places. They don't know which way to turn. Make Bethel a light in the midst of darkness, to where people can come and have hope, and that hope should not make them ashamed, but they should have the hope that is in Christ to raise them up in Jesus' name. Yes. That they be forever affected by the Spirit of the grace. Grace has a name, and his name is Jesus. He is the grace of God. Let him be exalted in this place with all due respect and honor as we give way and we yield to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Anybody else got anything to say? I don't want to do all the talking, so. Because I can. I can talk a lot. But I don't want that. I want participation. The reason I want that is because we sit in the pews sometimes too long. And because of frustration, because of denial, we grow weary. And it's hard for us to move sometimes because of it. So, don't let me talk all the time. Interrupt. I like interruption. Just interrupt. Say, Mike. Just like what happened this evening. I want to say something. I mean, somebody has to say something. Brother Roy, you know. Or whoever. Because it is through this participation in the kingdom of God that change will be effective. Amen?
Amen.
All right. Anybody else? You got something to say? You got something to say? You better start having something to say.
George,
I think George
is
one.
I'm doing good to talk.
Okay. George has his name. Now, George. So let's let our mouths declare the goodness of God, the faithfulness of God, the healing of God, not hoping for, because the scripture declares that healing is a done deal. What does it say in Peter? That we, Isaiah says, we are. Peter declared in the same scriptures, he changed it, because we're on this side of the cross, we were. We were healed by the stripes of Jesus. So no matter what the devil throws,
yes,
we were. You're no longer a rebellious child. You're no longer a captive of sin. You're not a sinner saved by grace. That's like an alcoholic saying, I'm still an alcoholic. But we are saints of the Most High God. We are children. God's children are not sinners. They are saved. Amen? You got to make up your mind that that we are what the scripture says we are. He has made us to be righteous. So we're not unrighteous. We are righteous, not because of what we do, because of what he did. We are holy, not because we have made ourselves holy. He has made us holy.
Yes.
So we have to come into agreement with what God has already done in order for that to be effective in change in our life. Our conversation, our mindset has got to change to the Word of God. Renewing your mind. We're so used to thinking in the world and what we used to be and the bondage that we used to be under that we fail to realize that we're not under that bondage. We're not what we used to be. We are new creatures.
That's right.
You didn't exist before you got born again, which you are now. So, don't blow up. Go ahead and sit.
She's thinking, I'm going to sit over there next time.
But there's good things for this.
If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature.
A new creature. Behold, old things are passed away. Behold, that means look. Check this out. All things are what? Become
new.
So the old has passed. Behold, all things are become new.
The Bible teaches us to put on that new nature.
Yes, it
every
does.
Day.
Every day.
And you do that in your relationship with Jesus Christ. What is that new nature? That new nature. New nature is Christ in us.
That's right. The Lord.
There's no easy way. There's no easy way to appropriate Christ in our life.
No.
We have to spend time with Him.
That's right.
It's just in any relationship.
Yeah.
You want to build a love relationship, you've got to spend time there.
Yep.
And that's...
You got to spend time with Him here.
Yep. That's it. And in His Word and in His presence.
Yeah. You spend time with this in this Word, and you find out what He is. And you find out what he's made you to be.
Yep.
And anything that the devil tries to throw at you that says that you are less than that is a liar. There is no truth in the devil.
That's right.
None. But there is truth in this Word. And the truth, the Bible says, will do what?
Set you free.
Not just set you free, made you free. Amen?
Yeah.
All right. That's so important. Everybody satisfied?
Yeah. Listen, encourage others to come for this meeting too. And if we can get a nucleus within the church that really wants to see God move, it's going to happen. Nothing's going to stop that.
That's right.
Yeah, and it doesn't take everybody being on board. It just takes a few that are really committed to that.
To take this one.
We come and...
it only took 12 to
show you. John was in the armor. Man. So I mean, God can do it, but the more the merrier, believe that. So let's encourage others to come and just get a hold of God. I want to see this happen more than anything else in the whole world.
So, amen. Yeah. Amen.
Well, let's expect great things this summer. Hallelujah. hallelujah. I want to see God do something wonderful.
I think it's appointed time, brother.
Yeah. And I did get a call to the hospital today about Judy. Just give a praise report before we leave. I called. Louise couldn't get a hold of me, so I called the hospital to get a hold of Rhythm. And this person answered the phone, and I said, it didn't sound like Louise. I said, is this Arlene, her sister? I knew it couldn't be Judy. Said, no. I said, who is this? Well, this is Judy.
Judy.
I almost started crying. I couldn't. I said, whoa. She said, yes, I feel good. If you'd have seen her last night at midnight, I'm telling you, man, it was just like looking at death. That's how bad it was.
Yeah.
Absolutely horrible. So it was a great turnaround there for her.
Yeah. Hallelujah.
Let's pray boldly. Let's pray believing.
Yes.
Let's claim the promises. I ended up school this morning, a guy with a broken foot, and the family that came, the kids came. She was supposed to come. I don't know why she didn't. It might be because he broke his foot. But, I said, well, let me go in. I'll let you go in front for him. And I'd never met him before. And he received me so well. He said, I believe that. I told him the story about how I fell in love. I said, let's believe right now for God to give you.
Amen.
I said, he says, yeah, I believe in the power of God. And I said, well, his name is Doug. See things like that take place, even in homes. They don't have to be in church, you can be in their homes.
Amen.
It could stir a revival. Amen. And doesn't that be me? It could be
anybody.
Yeah.
Amen.
And that's leadership, building that up, to have that influence in our community, and that boldness to see God do the impossible.
Amen,
sir. You can do that.
Amen, brother. That's what he wanted to raise all of us up to.
Yeah.
So it doesn't fall on one.
Yep. Exactly.
For so long it's fallen on one. We need to let it fall on us all.
Yeah. Amen. Yeah, it's when it falls on one. We just had a disaster within the ministry today. A person that many of us listen to on YouTube and followed this website, New Springs pastor, big church, thousands and thousands. And he fell into the sin of drunkenness. Last thing in the world I would ever expect it. And it just breaks my heart. But that's what happens when, and he's so successful. He's got this great ministry, but he struggled with depression. And you know, it just blows my brain. I thought, how can we preach it to others and we can't really appropriate that for ourselves? You know what it is? This is what it is. When we think we're invincible, we think we can do it all,
we're in trouble.
We're in trouble. We're in trouble. I don't care who it is. As long as we stay home for the Lord. And I don't know, it just crushed my heart. I found out just before I came here to tell my God. It just crushed my heart, I thought. I just hate it when a Jimmy Swaggart falls or something. Mm-hmm. I hate it.
But they're only men. Yeah, they're not only men. That's only it. They're all waiting to fall, just like
anybody.
Pastor or anybody. Me. You know, they praise the pastor, but they're...
We gotta guard ourselves, and we need each other. We need leadership around us.
Yes, sir.
That's for sure.
Thank you, Mike.
Very good, Mike.
Good, yes. Just beginning.
It's a good
man. Just beginning. Yeah. Yeah. So let's press in.
Yep.
We got to press into this. And I heard preachers used to say a pressing way is not an easy way, but it is a pressing way.
Yeah.
To be conformed to the image of Him who has called us out of bondage and into His marvelous light.
Yes.
To be conformed to Him. Who is the Christ, the Anointed One? Hallelujah.
Can we pray for that guy? His name is Doug. The guy with you.
Sure.
To manifest his
power
and follow up on it. If we can just agree for a few miracles start taking place around here, then we just rock this place with glory of God.
I'd like you to pray for my oldest sister. She's going to
operation. She's 75 years old. She's in a lot of pain and she can hardly walk. And that's a dangerous operation. That'll be Wednesday.
So let's believe God for that, okay?
Yeah.
Doug, yeah, let's pray for Sister Nicole too. Yes. I would love to see some miracles in George. Man, what a miracle that would be. I would escort him through Barnes Hospital and say, look what the Lord had done. All 17 floors, man. We would, I'm telling you, I'm serious.
Amen.
The whole St. Louis would know about that.
Or bring the Star of Lord's Church.
Right.
Yeah, Don Stewart. Don could, you know, these would be earth-shaking miracles. And Don,
amen.
I really believe these are things God wants to do. Mm-hmm. He's just waiting for people to get serious to pray about it.
Yeah.
And really seek his face.
Yeah.
And not just a quick 2-minute prayer like we're going to do here, but to go home and carry that burden and just carry it before the Lord for a day and be in the spirit of that prayer. God can do it.
Amen.
Let's just all be Lord, you flow through us. Let us not think you can't use any one of us at any moment. God, begin to give us and cast that vision in our hearts to be used of you.
Yes, Lord.
Lord, that's what we hear.
Yes.
Lord, that we might lead others to you.
Yes, Lord.
God, so bless this class. Anoint Brother Mike. Continue to heal his body, Lord. And Brenda, Lord, you say all the enemy has attacked them. And we thank you for the grace of God. There's something to overcome over and over and over again, Lord. May that spirit fill our hearts. And may we leave this place knowing that we are sent by God.
Yes.
We have all the authority of heaven behind us.
Yes, we
may
do.
We speak the word, and may we believe the word to be fulfilled, and may your name be glorified. We'll praise you for that, Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Yes, Father.
Lord, he'll dawn too. I'd like to pray both of them through Barnes. That was such a what an experience, God.
Mm.
Oh, Lord Jesus, there's nothing too hard for you. Nothing. Hallelujah.
You know, I'm reminded in Genesis, when God spoke to Adam, and he said, Adam, I'm going to paraphrase this, I've given you charge over this earth. To name all the animals, creatures, and everything else on it. And to replenish it. I've given you authority over this earth. Over all the creeping things, over all the things, all the fishes of the sea. He gave them authority over everything. That is the will and purpose of God. Man kind of blew it. But Jesus took what man lost and flipped it. And brought those, that same authority, back to those that would receive it.
Hallelujah.
Behold, I give you power over all the power of the enemy. Over sickness, over disease, over every lying devil, over devils. And sometimes we think that we're talking to the devil on this level, speaking to him face to face. But you got to remember, I sort of do that the other day. And I said, oh, I forgot, you're under my feet.
Oh, amen.
So you don't talk to the devil here. You talk to the devil there.
Amen.
He's under your feet.
Oh, yeah.
And we give him way too much credit.
Yes, we do.
So in him are all the promises, yea.
And,
and in him they are amen.
Yep.
Amen.
So the promises are what? We are healed. We are delivered. We are set free. We are no longer under bondage. But we've been made the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. We don't exist in the old life. We are new creatures. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah. So let's just agree. We've prayed for. But let's just pray that when this man goes and lays hands on that lady.
Mm-hmm.
Ooh, Jesus. I don't know about you guys, but I sense the anointing of the Holy Ghost. And Father, I believe that when he lays hands on that woman, that in the name of Jesus, that he'll speak without doubting, that he'll command that body to hear the word of God, that by the stripes of Jesus, that she was healed in Jesus' name. And that her body will respond to the word of God. And we believe the report of the Lord more than we believe the report of doctors or anybody else. Don't care what they've got to say. Your word is true.
Hallelujah.
Above all, every situation.
Yes.
Hallelujah. In Jesus' name. Let the anointing flow, Father.
Yes.
Let the anointing flow through him.
Yes.
Let the Holy Ghost flow through his life right now in Jesus' name. As he lays hands on this lady, Father, in Jesus' name, let him command healing. And let it be so.
Hallelujah.
And in you that they are amen. Yes, and then in you they are amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Woo, brother.
That's not Rita, is it?
No, it's his oldest sister, Jane.
Oldest sister, yeah.
Yeah, his oldest sister. She's, yeah. And then Rita is going, getting a hysterectomy. She just told us yesterday. So I don't know when that's.
She says she's a Christian, but.
Who, Rita?
I feel in my spirit.
The oldest one. Not. I don't either.
I just feel this in my spirit. She's not. She says, because I asked her one day, I walked her through the steps of salvation, and she said she did all of that. But you can say it, but unless it's coming from your heart,
yeah.
It's not going to happen.
Yeah.
And I just by listening to her talk, I don't think she's made that commitment.
Yeah. And, but aren't you glad that we don't have to be a Christian to be here?
That's right.
I've healed three or four times.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen. What a witness to her,
yeah.
That Jesus loves her,
yeah.
So much that he has healed her.
Somebody else can probably get to her better than me because family. It's hard to talk to family.
You don't have to talk. Right. All you got to do is lay hands in the name of Jesus.
Yeah.
Right. Hallelujah. She could have a sister, yeah.
Where is it? St. Anthony?
I think it's St. Anthony. She's having a time because she's supposed to
be 5:00 in the morning on Wednesday.
Yeah.
That's the best
5 or 6 she's supposed to be there.
Are you going to be going up there?
I'm going up and I'm not going
up. Not 5:00.
I'm going to go up a little bit later in the morning. I'm not going to go up at that time.
Well, the daughter and her sister is going to be there, so.
Would she be open for a visit?
Oh, sure.
Me and you to go over to
her? Sure, she would. Yeah, she would.
Let's pray and do that.
Yeah.
I would love to do that.
Yeah, she's.
Go with you. Just pray for her.
She is.
Okay. I would love that.
You can send some things.
Tomorrow would be good for me.
Okay.
Not the evening, but in the morning.
Not the appointment tomorrow at 11.
Uh-huh.
But after that, I'm
okay.
You better find.